Oh, thank you very much, Marianne, for this this introduction, and thanks Ingo a lot for your very insightful talk. And I look forward enormously also to hear the others. And of course, I'm very honored to be part of this. Yeah, I will discuss this climate case against Shell. This is a decision taken last May 26th by the District Court of The Hague. It's a tort law case. And interesting about it is that an injunction was issued, so no damages were asked. So the court issued an order saying that Shell must reduce 45% of its global emissions by 2030 compared to 2019 levels. And what I wanted to do in this very short talk is explain, firstly, the legal basis, then highlight two interesting features of the judgment, and you will see that there are common themes also with the German judgment. And lastly, I want to shortly say something about the democratic legitimacy in relation to the separation of powers, something on which Christina will later also expand. So let's start with the legal basis of this judgment. As said, it's a tort law case, and the legal basis of the case is are two provisions of the Dutch Civil Code. Firstly, it's articles 162 of book 6. And secondly, it's article 296 of book 3 of the Dutch Civil Code. That first provision, article 162, says that if you, basically says that if you commit a tort, then you will have to pay damages. Article 296 of book 3 of the Dutch Civil Code says, if you have a legal obligation, that the judge will order you to perform on that legal obligation. So it's actually those two articles combined, because from this first provision, the court distracts a legal obligation, and then with the second provision in hand, it orders to act upon this, this legal obligation. That article saying what article 162 inter alia says what constitutes a tort under Dutch civil law. And this is a very open norm of private law, as many of you might know, because it says something like that you can commit a tort by not behaving in a manner that is desirable in society, or something along those lines. It's a very old fashioned way of formulating there in the civil code. I love this language personally. And the court, what the court does to fill in this open norm is it uses 14 elements. Those include legal elements, but also more factual elements. So one important step is that the court refers back to the famous climate case Urgenda, a case against Dutch states, also based on tort law, at least on first instance, and later on directly based on human rights from the European Convention of Human Rights, and saying that this Dutch state has based on international human rights law, European Court of Human Rights law, a positive duty to act against climate change. So climate change is a human rights law matter, is very basic summary of the Urgenda case. With that in hand, the court also looks at the United Nations guiding principles on business and human rights, which of course say that whereas states have the obligation to respect, protect and fulfill human rights, companies have the sole responsibility to respect human rights. Now, given that Shell is one of the major contributors to global emissions, the court concludes that Shell has to respect human rights in the sense that they have to make sure that they do not cause that many emissions, that the threshold of 1.5 degrees Celsius global warming will be reached, meaning that Shell has to seriously reduce its emissions. And it bases this also on all kinds of scientific insights. Yes, okay. Then I, so that's for the legal basis in a nutshell. And I think André Nolkemper, Professor André Nolkemper will also expand on this. Then I wanted to highlight two features of the judgment that I find interesting. Firstly, that the environmental organizations who launched this case were allowed standing on behalf of future generations. And that's interesting. The same happened in this Urgenda case, the Dutch case against the state on first instance, But on appeal, the courts, both courts, Court of Appeal and the Supreme Court, said this was not necessary because the environmental organizations had standing anyway, also for people who already live now, because they already had a sufficient interest to bring this case. This is extra interesting because in this case, the court actually says that for the proportionality of the order, also the interest of people who are already alive are sufficient to justify this order against Shell, because it also acknowledges that Shell will have to make some sacrifices plausibly in executing this order. Interestingly, this also contrasts a bit with the German case, which indeed, of course, is very much basing itself on this idea of intergenerational equity. But the German case is considered with people who are already alive. And in this case, explicitly standing is allowed on behalf of the unborn. Standing was not allowed, a bit similar to the German case, on behalf of people abroad, because there was one environmental organization that was said to represent those people and that was not allowed standing. Nevertheless, I think, and that's highlight too, this judgment has a global effect because Shell was ordered to reduce its scope 1, 2, and 3 emissions. This is jargon from the Greenhouse Protocol, a private initiative that many companies use to, and by the way, also states, to report on their emissions. The so-called scope 1 emissions are the emissions from your own site, like what's coming from the chimney in the buildings you own. Scope 2, emissions caused by generating the energy you use. So that's emissions, well, elsewhere, not in your own home or site. And scope 3 are all other emissions. And interesting for this case, of course, is that these include emissions caused by the consumption of the products that you produced. So in the case of Shell, Shell's consumers burning its gasoline, driving their cars, for instance. I have to say more about this, but I will not do it because I want to move on to also one interesting thing, namely the third part, the democratic legitimacy. Or separation of powers argument. Shell has, or the CEO of Shell, I put that in the picture there on the slide, 2 days ago, published an answer to the case on LinkedIn, saying that, it's a bit ambiguous message, saying that Shell will rise to the challenge, but is also very disappointed and still considers to appeal. And in particular, he says he finds it unfair that only Shell is bound and not other oil companies. And I think that this argument can be translated into two levels, or at least can be understood on two levels. So first, one can say, okay, the court made the wrong decision. Given the law, the court should have made another decision. And secondly, perhaps it's not the court, but the legislator that should change the law that so that these kinds of cases do not occur. So first, perhaps some words on did the court render the wrong decision. I think not, and actually I'm quite happy with how the court constructed its order private law-wise, because the claimants had argued based on the doctrine of hazardous negligence, which translates then in a duty to take precautionary measures. If you create unnecessary danger, you have to take precautionary measures. The court actually says something different. So it doesn't base itself on this doctrine of hazardous negligence, but rather makes a new, renders a new interpretation, makes new interpretation of the more open norm of tort law in general, and says that Shell has a negative duty. And I think that this actually, well, for various reasons is better, also doctrinally, private law-wise, but also I think it's better in line with the United Nations guiding principles on business and human rights, because they stress that businesses have a negative obligation not to violate human rights, and they do not have so much positive duties to do things. Now, of course, this is a bit of a conceptual small difference, because it will mean that Shell has to do something active to restructure its business. So, on a more wider level, what I find personally very interesting also about this case is that it confirms again that climate change is a human rights matter. So indeed, I wrote a PhD thesis on this topic of democratic legitimacy of judicial lawmaking in these kinds of cases. So very much very much thinking about the separation of powers. And in a nutshell, what I observe there is that there is an ongoing constitutionalization of the environment, also known as environmental constitutionalism. And I think that increases the legitimacy of judicial interference in these kinds of cases. Now, I will keep it very short because I see I'm already over time, but I'm almost finished. So the other argument, did the court render the wrong decision? She also says this impacts its level playing field, but the court actually responds to that in the judgment saying, well, all companies have the obligation to respect human rights. And also it's questionable whether this will actually impact the level playing field because there are already, we can see many signs that the energy transition has begun. So it's not even certain whether if Shell now sells certain gas and oil sites, that then these will actually be burned still by with the help from other oil companies. Plus, I think it's important to remind ourselves that the court can't help anyway, that only Shell is sued. So that's not perhaps criticism we should deliver to the court. And the other argument is, of course, that we must change the law so that these kinds of cases do not occur. And in a way, I would very much agree with that because, of course, climate litigation is definitely a response to a failure of legislatures to come up with effective climate change litigation. You can also understand this argument in another way, leading to a debate about whether environmental or public interest organizations should have standing. I think that's another debate. I will leave that aside for now. So these were some of my small observations on the case, and I look very much forward to the discussion. And if there's no room today, I'm always open to discuss it afterwards as well. So thank you very much for your attention.